Cosa Nostra, The Notorious History and Legacy of the Sicilian Mafia. Written by Charles River Editors. Narrated by Jim D. Johnston. Table of Contents. Introduction. The Sour Origins of the Cosa Nostra. Cosa Nostra comes to America. Fascism. World War II and the Rebirth of the Cosa Nostra. The Mafia Wars. Introduction. The term Mafia found a class of violent criminals ready and waiting for a name to define them, and given their special character and importance in Sicilian society, they had the right to a different name from that defining vulgar criminals in other countries. Leopoldo Franchetti, 1876. It is hard to find an island on the map more central than Sicily, located at the crossroads between Europe and Africa and between the eastern and western Mediterranean. Sicily has rarely been governed as an independent, unified state. Yet the island has always occupied a front-row seat to some of the most important events in history, and nowhere is this more obvious than during antiquity. Sicily feels like a different country in many ways, and the differences between Sicilians and Italians are much vaster than the tiny geographic separating them might intimate. For example, the linguistic differences between the two are substantial, as Sicilian is practically its own language rather than just a dialect. It differs from Italian most apparently insofar as the normal final O of masculine nouns is replaced by a U, but beyond that difference, there are lengthy, five-syllable words that a standard Italian tongue tends to trip over. In fact, most Italians have difficulty understanding Sicilian if they can comprehend any of it at all. There's also an ethnic difference between Sicilians and Italians. Most notably, many Sicilians have bright red hair and light eyes, which is usually thought to be a result of the Norman invasions, although today some historians believe it is because of the strong presence of the British during the Napoleonic Wars, as well as the Anglo-American occupation of Italy during World War II. Even Sicilian cuisine varies from the Italian mainland. Sicily is celebrated for having 72 different kinds of bread, and Sicilians often eat ice cream, gelato, for breakfast. However diverse Sicily might be, it is also paradoxically considered to be an emblem of Italy itself, a paradox it shares with Naples. No writer put it more aptly than the great romantic poet Goethe. In an April 13, 1787 letter from Palermo, published in Journey to Italy, Goethe made the following declaration. To have seen Italy without having seen Sicily is not to have seen Italy at all, for Sicily is the clue to everything. As Goethe's words suggest, Sicily is unquestionably unique, thanks to its turbulent and rich history, but it shares the same qualities as the Italian nation overall, from its beautiful scenery, delicious cuisine, dazzling sunshine, and unparalleled cultural production, to its problems with law and order, and its seeming impenetrability to outside visitors. Over the course of the 19th century, the people of Sicily found themselves at the center of a struggle for freedom, one that ended up being long and often very bloody. It was during these crucial years of struggle that the Sicilian Mafia, La Cosa Nostra, or Our Thing, started to take shape. The original word Mafia was a part of Palermitan slang, and although the origins of the word are not completely certain, some linguistic historians believe it originally meant flashy. One historian of the Mafia, Salvatore Lupo, helpfully suggests that it was used in its earliest iterations to vaguely refer to a pathological relationship among politics, society, and criminality. In response to the rise of the Mafia, the Italian state propagated a doctrine of Sicilian backwardness, which they used to introduce martial law and suspend civil liberties, under the pretext that they were not ready for the freedoms enjoyed by other Italian regions. Northerners and foreigners mistakenly and snobbishly believed that the Mafia was just a relic of the primitive peasant culture that had dominated the island for centuries, and that it was destined to die out once the island had been properly absorbed into the dominant mainland culture. Others hypothesized that the corruption in Sicilian culture was just a holdover from the Bourbon government and would soon be extinguished once a formal transition was completed. Of course, they were proved to be dead wrong. The Sicilian Mafia was not a criminal underworld or a form of political rebellion, but more of a kingdom within a kingdom. In other words, according to historians of the Mafia, it was a network of hidden power, an alternative hierarchy that sometimes worked in concert with and sometimes superseded official forms of law and order. By 1890, the Cosa Nostra had already developed into a sophisticated criminal organization with a great deal of blood on its hands. In fact, its tentacles reached into the highest levels of politics and beyond the borders of Sicily and Italy, traveling across the Atlantic to the United States. Today, their power has been dwarfed by the Neapolitan mafia, La Camorra. Yet, the Cosa Nostra has continued to wreak havoc in Sicily. In 1992, they were responsible for one of the most high-profile assassinations in Italy since the fall of fascism. Ironically, the murderous actions of a small segment of society have caused the Sicilian people in general to be perceived as mafiosi, even though the vast majority of them have been victims rather than perpetrators. Cosa Nostra, the notorious history and legacy of the Sicilian Mafia, examines how the world's most famous mob formed, its inner workings, and the events that made it feared around the world. Along with pictures of important people, places, and events, you will learn about the Sicilian Mafia like never before. The Sour Origins of the Cosa Nostra. The 19th-century writer E. A. Freeman describes Sicily as the central island of the civilized world. While this description is dated, it emphasized the importance of Sicily's position, located at the center of the Mediterranean Sea between Italy and Africa. It controls the pass between the eastern and western Mediterranean by sea, the pass between Italy and Europe to the north, and Tunis and Africa to the south by land. Sicily is furthermore the largest island in the Mediterranean. Its shape is practically like a triangle, with angles pointing west, northeast, and southeast, and the tip of its western point slightly cut off. To the northeast, Sicily is located so close to Italy, the crossing between the tip of Italy's boot and the northeastern point of Sicily at its narrowest is less than 2 miles wide, that it was believed in ancient times to have once formed a contiguous landmass with the mainland. In antiquity, the island of Sicily was very fertile and suited for agriculture. It was rich in wine, and especially in grain. Thus, it should come as little surprise that the worship of Demeter, the goddess of agriculture, was widespread on the island. Sicily was also famously rich, both in mythological and, in historic times, in livestock, with many sheep and cattle. Tangentially, it was one of the birthplaces of bucolic poetry in the 4th century BCE, and fast horses. Several Olympic victories for Sicilians are recorded, especially in chariot racing and horse racing events. Despite its fertility, however, the island as a whole is also very mountainous. There was always a strong division between the coasts and the interior of the island. In the classical period, colonists like the Greeks and Phoenicians tended to keep to the coasts, while the interior of the island was inhabited by more or less independent native states for a very long time. In later times, armies wishing to avoid capture or confrontation would pass through the interior of the island, and revolts would almost invariably.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.